What I want to talk about this morning is a project called Good Faith. And we, you know, I've been at Barna Group now for 22 years. I'm a geek for Christ's sake, all right? So I'm a social researcher. We've done more than a million interviews, social research interviews, in the 22 years that I've been there. My father's a lifelong pastor of a church in Phoenix. And so I thought I would actually be a local church pastor, and I read one of George Barna's books and thought, wow, this is really cool. I can use sort of my geeky mind for ministry. And so I volunteered to be an intern at the Barna Group, and for 22 years I've been there now, and it's been a wonderful place. What we think about our work is Issachar, try to understand the times, right? Understand what's happening in our culture, to know what God is up to, and then what to do. This is 1 Chronicles 12:32. And so for the next few minutes, what I want to describe is some of the headwinds that we face, because we can complain about politics, and we can complain about human sexuality and sexual mores and all sorts of things about the next generation, and we will get to that in our time this morning. But I want to describe a little bit about sort of these overarching cultural trends, and we're going to begin by talking about the tension that we feel and why. And I'm going to try to use technology here and see if this will work. Oh, here it goes. Great. Okay, so the tension we feel and why. And I believe, as a social researcher, that there are a couple of key perceptions, a couple of key things that are headwinds for Christian ministry today. One is the perception of irrelevance, and the other is the perception that Christianity is extreme, or that we are extremist. Being irrelevant means things like 59% of young millennials, people who grow up in the church, will either walk away from their faith or from the church by the time they're in their mid-20s, right? So they grow up as a Christian, but 59% will walk away, and that is a huge indication of the irrelevance of faith. We're going to talk a little bit more about that whole trend in our second session together in about an hour from now. Another example of irrelevance of faith is that most people have no real idea of the fact that most of the social good that happens in our communities, serving the poor, helping the homeless, providing even literacy and after-school programs. Most people don't believe, they have no idea that faith-related organizations and churches and Christians provide the vast majority of that. That's just another example of the irrelevance of faith. Most Americans believe that would happen with or without the church. Now, we live in a culture that is very Christianized, but is not necessarily Christ-following, right? When we ask in our surveys, what percentage of Americans would you imagine say that they've made a personal commitment to Jesus Christ that is still important in their life? What percent? Take a guess. Well, that was a lot of good guesses. I couldn't distinguish any single one of them. All right, so it's 69% of Americans say they've made a personal commitment to Jesus Christ that is still important in their life. 7 out of 10 Americans say that they pretty much have Jesus nailed. Right? That's amazing to me. We live in a Christianized country, but not necessarily a Christ-following one. That's another example of the irrelevance of faith. Now, my mother-in-law is a lifelong Christian, doesn't attend church very often. This is another example of the irrelevance of faith. A few years ago, she was at her home. We're watching the Discovery Channel, and we're watching a program about big cats, pumas and jaguars and lions and all the rest. And during the commercial break, my mother-in-law, Janice, says, "In my next life, Dave, I would like to be reincarnated as a tiger." Now, I went to Biola University. I grew up in a pastor's home. I have to be honest that there wasn't, all the theological training that I had at that moment, I didn't quite know what to say to my mother-in-law, and the best that I could come up with was, "You know, Janice, they are beautiful animals." Honestly, don't judge, but that's the verbatim what came out. So the next morning, my wife had already gone to bed. The next morning, I said, "Honey, your mom is a tiger mom. I now have proof." And so we discussed the implications of this, and so she said, no, I don't think that, I think she's just being clever, but we talked to her about it recently, and she's like, no, I really want to be a tiger in my reincarnated state. That's what I'm hoping for. I was like, I don't even think it works that way, but if it did, that's, you know, you don't get to choose. So for her birthday, that same year, my wife got a greeting card for Janice that had a beautiful tiger waiting in a jungle pool. It was a beautiful photograph on the front, but it was blank on the inside. So that leaves a sort of a troublemaker like me to my own devices. And so I wrote, happy birthday, Janice. You know, I hope your wildest dreams come true. But there was a whole lot of things that were up here. It was like, you know, you're almost there. Go get him, tiger. Earning your stripes every day. I mean, there's lots of things, you know. When your mother-in-law wants to be a tiger in her reincarnated self, there is a lot of comedic potential there, it turns out. All right, so that is an example of the irrelevance of faith, right? Is that we can have people who are lifelong Christians who really have no concept of Christian theology. So that's another example. So irrelevance, if we were to draw a line graph, we'll just use the stage here to imagine, you know, irrelevance throughout human history, religion has been very relevant for most of human history. But over the last, since the Enlightenment and since, you know, sort of the scientific age, there's been this long, slow growing reality of the irrelevance of faith, right? People have, here's keywords, an impregnable fortress of indifference to faith, right? Most of our efforts fail because we think that the world is hanging on our every word, but they have an impregnable fortress of indifference, right? Now, extremism is a new thing. We think it's rising in collective culture. It is things like this that nearly half of Americans believe that religion is part of the problem in our culture, 46%, and that people of faith at 42%, that people of faith are part of the problem. And what this is different because it is not, irrelevance is that you can ignore faith, you can get a flyer in your mailbox and come to Easter services at this nice church, and you can just, oh, that's nice, we're fine. Extremism is that you would actually attach a brick to that piece of postcard and say, return to sender, right? And that is like, we're gonna actually suck money out of your organization for the audacity that you would try to market to us, right? Like that is the shift in the mindset. It is an angrier, it is a greater degree of skepticism. It is the sense that religion isn't just something to be ignored, it is something that must be constrained. It must be limited. It is bigoted. It is unfair. It is the wrong side of history. It is all of these negative perceptions, right? Here in California, I'm on the board at Biola University, and here in California, as some of you may know, last year there was a piece of legislation here in Sacramento that was under consideration to take Cal grants away from any student who attended a Christian college or university in the state of California if it had discriminatory language in its practices. Now, this is all around issues of the LGBT community and same-sex attraction and other kinds of things. And this was an example of extremism. See, for decades, Christian colleges and universities have operated freely here in the state of California. But last year, it was like, no, religion is actually harmful. These practices are actually doing harm to students. And so we must find a way to constrain the ability of students to go to that kind of school. Here's another example. This is a little picture from Instagram from November of 2015 after the attacks at Paris. And it says, friends from the whole world, thank you for the hashtag pray for Paris, but we don't need more religion. Our faith goes to music and to kisses and to life and to champagne and to joy. Hashtag Paris is about life, it's not about religion. In our research in this book we did called Good Faith with my good friend Gabe Lyons, we detail more than 20 different things that are now considered to be extremist by a good percentage of people in America. These are examples. This is four of those 20 or so things that we document in the book. But 93% of Americans believe that to use religion to justify violence, that's extremist. Of course, we would agree with that. But how about this? Trying to convert others. 60% now believe that if you try to convert others to your religious faith, that is an example of extremism. You're trying to do harm to someone else's mindset, right? 52%, if you were to believe that same-sex relationships are morally wrong, they would say that's extremist. Or to quit a good job to pursue missions, that is extremist. Now, part of my goal in doing this project is to help encourage theologically conservative, you know, sort of like what we would consider orthodox individuals to understand the power of these beliefs. In fact, we want to encourage you to be the right kind of extreme and the right kind of irrelevant in our culture. Right? We're hoping that you would take the cues of this, not to sort of reinvent what we think Christianity should say in the world. I mean, my friend Gabe Lyons and I, we read hundreds of books and talked to thousands of people about issues of same-sex attraction. We have three chapters in the book to try to help navigate these very complex questions of sex and sexuality. And we have come very clearly to the conclusion that we think that this age-old teaching, this historic understanding of human sexuality, that it is to be expressed, that sex is designed for a covenant relationship between one man and one woman, is what God has designed for human beings. But that doesn't make sense in our world today. And we want you to understand, what I want to help you understand today is why the mindset of this world is different and it's changing, and how we can be salt and light in this very complicated age. So irrelevance and extreme is some of the challenges that we face. As we go along, I just want to remind you that, you know, like, again, this idea of being on the right kind of extreme and the right kind of irrelevant. One of the percentages that we talk about in this project is that 55% of people believe that if you were to pray for a stranger in public, that would be extreme. And right after this book came out in April of 2016, the Good Faith Project, we were at the Grand Canyon, and my family was going to hike to the bottom, and we were in the Grand Canyon Lodge, and one of the young women who were helping us there with some of the merchandise, she was limping, and I asked her a little bit about why she was limping, and she said she had gone on a long hike and really had to come into work that day, otherwise she felt like she might lose her job. And I said, in my head, and sometimes I'm weird, like little like stat bubbles appear above people's heads. It's like 55% of people think that it's extreme to pray for a stranger, right? And my son Zach was with me, he's 12, and so I'm like, would you mind if I pray for you? And she was sort of taken aback by that, but she said, I think that'd be fine, thanks. And so I prayed, nothing miraculous happened in that moment. But she thanked me as we finished, and then my son Zach, as we're walking out, you know, away from her, my son Zach was like, man, Dad, we really believe this stuff, don't we? I just want you to think about that. Right? Like, part of what is happening now for millennials, for Gen Z, is they're waiting to see whether we will be, in fact, driven by this gospel, driven into the dark places of the world, right? Driven into the hospitals and into the brain cancer units. Like, what will our faith actually look like in these really difficult places, in these very human questions? And I think sometimes we can have a real intellectual and, you know, kind of like we're theologically astute. You know, 1 Corinthians 13 says, even if I understand all theological doctrine, but I don't have love, I'm like a clanging gong. Now, let me explain another dimension of the challenge that we face. And we live in a very interesting, what we call this new moral code, a self-centered age. And let me show you some of the examples of this. When we got the polling back about a year, year and a half ago, I was flabbergasted by the results. Flabbergasted is a word we should use more often in our daily conversation, by the way. That's a good one. Look, so 91% of Americans believe that the best way to find yourself is to look within yourself. What kind of crap is that, guys? Right? 91% of Americans say that the best way to find yourself is to look within yourself. I'm going to show you some stats in our second session, just how much this is part of the worldview, not just of the next generation, friends, but of our culture, right? We are increasingly self-centered in the ways that we think about. I think this is even in the church. We think a lot about what we're building and how we are partnering with what God is doing in the world. And so we are becoming increasingly self-centered. Here's another example. People should not criticize someone else's life choices at 89%. This is the ultimate party foul now, right? To criticize someone else's life choice. This is why it is, I think, so difficult, friends, in some ways to speak clearly on these issues, because when you preach and when you teach, there will certainly be people whose lives are right in the crosshairs of those circumstances and situations and perceptions and ideals. And again, preaching, we'll say a little bit more about this in a few minutes, but preaching is really difficult to communicate when many of even our Christian lifelong churchgoers are thinking to themselves like, well, you know, it sounds like you're being a little judgmental there. Right? How about this? People can believe whatever they want as long as those beliefs don't affect society. Not even logically possible. Think about pornography in our culture today. We did a big study called The Porn Phenomenon with Josh McDowell Ministries. And it's amazing to me to look at teenagers who are telling us that when they have a conversation with one of their peers, only 1 out of 10 teenagers tell us that it is a morally condemning, or it's, they would say that when I speak about pornography, my friends and I agree it really is something we should not do. 9 out of 10 are either accepting or neutral, or they don't talk about it. Like, you know, in Scripture where it says that evil will be called good and good will be called evil. We live in an era of reversalism. Right? And we found in the research on pornography, for example, that teens are more likely to say that it is morally wrong to not recycle than to view pornography. One thing that my mentor, George Barna, taught me is that you don't have to like the trends, but you do have to deal with the trends. And we don't have to like this, but look at how our moral center, the way we think about morality, is like everyone is sort of a king and queen unto themselves, and that, you know, we've created this sort of uneven and really unsustainable moral culture in which, you know, it's like, well, just everyone do what you want to do, right? This is like the very last verse in Judges, right, which it says, what? Everyone did what was right in their own eyes. Nothing's new under the sun, but we are now living in an era when there is an increasingly narcissistic self at the center of our morality. Let me just show you my daughter, Annika. She's my middle daughter. We were looking in a furniture magazine last year, and she was noticing, and I thought it was really cool of her, that she was noticing that some of the artwork, even the way they advertise furniture and posters and the mantras of this new generation, reinforce this sort of experience and self at the center. So here you can buy a poster that says, you only live once, right? Go for it, you only live once. Or how about this, a little throw pillow that has a really wonderful biblical philosophy here, I want it all. Or how about a poster, all good things are wild and free. Now I just sat and pondered that one for a while, and I was thinking to myself, I had some macadamia nut, coconut chip ice cream last weekend that was neither wild nor free, so that's not even a logically possible phrase, right? It was really awesome, and it was not wild or free. So, like, I just think it's so interesting the way that our generation is being conditioned to think. If you watch media, if you think about the stories that are being portrayed, if you think about the sort of the trajectory of the way that media is telling the stories of what it means to be on a journey and to find yourself, and you may or may not really find a life partner in marriage. So just work it out as you go. I mean, all of these mantras are consistent with a new kind of thinking of finding yourself in the journey. You know, finding yourself somewhere outside of rootedness, right? Like you don't have to find yourself in a community, in a church, in a job, in a family. You can find yourself out there somewhere. Now, we're living in a really complicated context, and that this is what I want to end sort of this first portion of our time. I'm trying to talk about the problems we're facing, and they're more complicated than we like to acknowledge sometimes. But sometimes we talk about issues like same-sex attraction or other things that we might be concerned about, but there is this deeper reality that is sort of the undercurrents of what is creating the conditions for ministry. And God is calling us to be faithful in our thinking about that. And living in a complex age, we don't have to like the trends, we don't have to condone these perspectives, but we do have to understand them in order to minister effectively in them and to them. About 10 or 12 years ago, I was a volunteer for our local youth church, for our youth group at our church in Southern California. I live in Ventura, California, about a 6 to 7 hour drive from here. Flew up yesterday, and so I'm one of my best friends, Eddie Ramos, is the youth pastor 12 years ago. We're working diligently in youth ministry. One of the young women is graduating from high school. Her name is Colleen, and she wants to go off to college, and she asks Eddie this really interesting question. She says, Eddie, what would the Bible have to say about selling my eggs? Now, Ventura, California, if you've ever driven through there, is an agricultural sort of area along the coast. We've got strawberry fields and other kinds of things, and Oxnard is right near there. And for a minute, friends, I was like, I didn't realize that Colleen, who lives in an apartment, had any backyard chickens. But she had found online a fertility clinic, and for thousands of dollars, she could donate her eggs. And wouldn't that be a really cool, like, thing to do for a family that can't have children, she asked. Well, that we didn't learn in youth pastor school, right? See, here's the thing. What I'm asking us to consider is that we're living through this shift here in the United States, in North America, and I realize we have churches, you know, from all over, and we're living in a new kind of context. But I would like to argue here that what's happening, what the tension we're feeling and why, is that some of us grew up in an era of ministry that was very Jerusalem-like. Faith is at the center, it's monotheistic, it's a slower pace. The idol is a false piety, because humans create idols even in monotheistic cultures, right? There is a sense of control, there's a simpler life. But in Babylon, or we might call it digital Babylon, we live in digital Babylon. It's not about a place, but it's about the way that screens and the uber presence, the ubiquitous nature of screens in our lives are affecting our sense of reality. It's estimated that the typical teenager is spending more than 6 hours a day on screens and with media, right? How can we disciple in digital Babylon? Faith is in the margins, it's pluralistic, it's accelerated and frenetic, the idol is fitting in and being up to speed. It's an open source and a bittersweet tension. Let me just tell you a simple story that illustrates this contest, this shift. My daughter, Annika, a few years ago, she was in a Christian school, K-8, and they're going up to outdoor education in the school bus. And she and her friend Callie at this Christian school retreat started singing 99 bottles of beer on the wall. And Mrs. Vargas says, "Ani, beer?" And my sweet daughter Ani says, "Oh, I'm sorry, Mrs. Vargas, is it supposed to be about wine?" It's this tension, right? Like, my daughter Anna's like, what sort of mixed drink are we supposed to be singing about? All right, here's another way of thinking about that. In Jerusalem, monotheism is assumed, idolatry is fought. But in Babylon, idolatry is assumed, and monotheism is fought, right? Extremism. God's people must be holy. There's an emphasis on behavior, on rule following, but there's a real emphasis on identity, on faithfulness. And I want to make the argument that we are now living in these sort of different subcultures, right? We are finding ourselves, I think, as a church, living in these different tensions. And so that is there's much more we could talk about in terms of the headwinds. Some people think that we have the spiritual gift of discouragement as researchers, as Barna people. But now let's turn our attention to some of the things we can do about these trends. All right, so let's talk about some of the ways. There aren't simple solutions for complex problems. I had a pastor not so long ago come to me and said, I'm gonna try one more time, to find a young pastor who can speak to millennials. But if I can't find that person, I just don't know what I'm going to do. And I know that's how we feel, and it was an honest expression, but think of it, we're trying to use, like, if I could just find that magic young hire, maybe these more complicated problems will kind of subside. And I want you to think with me today that if we're gonna face up to a really complicated problem, like our culture, like the new morality, and by the way, a majority of practicing Christians embrace those same three things that I just described to you. We live in a very complicated world where even in our churches, people's hearts and minds are being colonized by digital Babylon. How can we disciple effectively? Well, I have four ideas for us this morning we could think about. First is this idea of being countercultural. The church is a counterculture for the common good. This is our mantra. We think differently, we believe differently. Instead of, for example, what's happening in our culture is that people are sort of saying truth is discovered from within. But Scripture teaches us something different, right? We have an external source of authority. Scripture and Jesus, right? Like we don't blindly trust political leaders or other leaders, but we realize that truth is external to us. So let me show you a few examples. So the best way to find yourself is to look within yourself. Instead, a countercultural way to think is that you find yourself by discovering the truth about yourself outside of yourself in Jesus. The Scriptures tell us over and over that our heart is wicked and can't even tell ourselves, we don't even tell ourselves the truth. I love in Psalm 119, which is like, teach me to tell myself the truth. Right? Like there's these wonderful ways in which Scripture helps us. By the way, one of the things our family does to help, we have a very ambitious family. We're kind of drivers and we are achievers and all the rest. And so one of the things that I've been doing recently, the last year or so, year and a half, is that at the dinner table, we don't always read a section of Scripture, but we often do. And we have been reading Ecclesiastes together. And I think Ecclesiastes is a wonderful antidote to a driven and ambitious generation, to an ambitious and driven Kinnaman family. And it was so sweet. One of my daughters plays basketball, and she came back after a tough start to the season last fall, and she said, I told my teammates about Ecclesiastes that, like, worrying about our stats is all vanity. And I was like, so proud of her, right? Like, she's doing cultural analysis. She's bringing a theological perspective to the stats, right? And Ecclesiastes was this little bit of an antidote to the self-centered, like, I worry about what stats I'm going to have in this basketball season. All right, people should not criticize someone else's life choices. How about if we should always be kind, but that doesn't always mean that we go along to get along. Or how about this idea of God gives people the freedom to believe what they want, but those beliefs inevitably affect society. Could we talk about the impact that porn has? How do we think well about this and describe the challenges? In my own family, friends, I mean, this is. I just want to tell you how I'm thinking about this. Like, this isn't just a bunch of academic, my PowerPoint slides. Like, I am thinking about this as a father to three kids. And so with my own kids, especially with my boy, but with my girls, I talk with them all about sexuality, especially with my boy. I talk about pornography. By the way, in the screen age, one of the challenges of pornography is that women are becoming more addicted to pornography than ever before because of the ease of access. By the way, I mean, just think about the screen age. For the first time in human history, in this room, there are explicit sexual images, right? Pornography isn't new, sexual addiction isn't new, but the access, the tools, the digital Babylon is new. How do we give people a theology thick enough to live lives of purity and holiness in that context? That is a tough question. With my own kids, I've been thinking about how do we describe this idea of the impact. And I've been saying to my kids, like, guys, like, this is, it's not, you know, if you're going to see sexually explicit images in television and movies or online, it's more like when. And guys, I am so sorry how hard it is for you to grow up in purity. And like, we could take all of the screens out of our house, but guess what? You're gonna inevitably go to a workplace or a friend's house. Like how will we do this? And even more importantly, guys, like, you know, it's like 100% of young men who at least sort of dabble with online pornography. And I was talking to my son Zach, I was like, listen, I care about you and your soul, but I also care about your generation. And God wants you to be on mission with your friends who are gonna absolutely struggle with this, because, man, I don't even know how to do it. Like, it's really, really hard. And so my little boy is, he's a big guy now. He's 13, almost 13 years old. And I can just tell his heart is beginning to awaken to the challenges and to the, like, how God might be calling him. By the way, this is just, again, how I am thinking about this as a parent. And I'm telling you this so that in your families and with your kids and with your grandkids, and then even in your churches, you could think well and begin to speak about these issues. I decided to speak to my own boy about sex at a much earlier age. With all my kids, I talked to them much earlier than I remember my dad talking to me about it, right? I was about to go on my first date. I'm just kidding. I was in sixth grade, and I remember saying, oh, I really like this girl, Jane Herrera, in my class. My dad's like, you know, I think I need to have a conversation with you. But I decided to have the conversation with my boy at third grade. And here's the thing, I don't want Google to be his sex educator. And so we talked about it, and we've had a series of conversations. It's not just the one conversation, but it is a series of conversations that we have with our kids about growing up pure and growing up resistant to the spirit of the age, and how, you know, all sorts of different things, not just about sexuality, even about cynicism and snarkiness. And like, we've been watching reruns of The Office, and I've been warning them. I was like, hey guys, this is funny, but I just want you to know, like, this is actually really true about how offices work. And what's hard is that I don't want you to go into these workplaces and think this is like the normal way you should respond to things by just joking about it. Like, there is a biblical way that we should respond to the world. So here's the thing, I have this conversation with my son Zach about sex, and here's the thing, you know, his eyes get big, and we're talking about how this all works and the logistics of it and all the rest, and he says to me, Dad, thank you for telling me. I always understood that the babies came from their mom's tummies, but I never understood how they got the genetics of their dads. His favorite show on television is Mythbusters. Right? Like his brain is thinking in a certain way about, like, and I promise, had I waited another few months or 6 months or whatever, he would have, like, you know, Google is right there. It is a safe place to ask any question that you want. That's brilliant. That's awesome. It's awesome, right? Why would you not use Google for a lot of this stuff? But this is the point, right? Will our Christian communities, will your churches be the places that have this theological robustness that can prepare families to live faithful lives in an era when all the rules are gone, when all the boundaries have changed, when your third grade son says, I never understood how they get the genetics of their dad? The beauties and mysteries of God's creation. And we think, I don't really want to talk about it because it's a little awkward to speak about this with a third grader. That's the new reality. So being countercultural means we are doing this. We are having, here's the second idea. We're being countercultural is the first idea. The second is that we're having difficult conversations. We're choosing as families to lean in and to talk about the difficult conversations. We live wisely with non-believers. We learn to have conversations that are gracious and effective. Let me give you a couple of examples of how this would work. Good faith Christians understand the relational consequences of sexual freedom, and we offer a better way. In relation to the whole issue of same-sex attraction, one of the things that I am being continually confronted by is that we don't really understand how, we think about this on an intellectual level, but we don't always think about it on a relational or a hospitality level. And let me just tell you one quick story about that. My brother-in-law, Brian, passed away from HIV/AIDS about 6 years ago. And I have to be honest, I write about this whole story in the book Good Faith, because it was hard to talk about, but it was important for me to share my own failings in this, that I never saw Brian as anything other than my gay brother-in-law. And that even my dad and all of the Christian, he passed away, Brian passed away in Phoenix where my parents live, and like, we never had a close relationship with him, but none of us as Christians went and visited him during his final days. And I was going back, God in his mercy kind of helped me understand that if I had gone back, the relational consequences of sexual freedom, if I had gone back to those early days when I began to understand how Brian was thinking about the trajectory of his life and he began to have a partner and other things, I just wonder if I had said, Brian, you know, I just want you to know that if you want to have a family, Brian, I'd invite you to live with our family. Not, you know, maybe we have to have some tough discussions around what that does and doesn't include. I don't want your partner living with us. But when you're ready, if you want to have pancakes on Saturday morning with our kids, and you want to watch movies with our family, and you want to have relationships, like, you could be a part of our family. I never had that conversation because I never saw Brian as anything other than my gay brother-in-law. And I'm sharing this story with you. How do we prepare to live lives on missions, life on mission with Jesus when we're not prepared to have these kind of difficult conversations? A third idea is that we need a pedagogical renewal in our churches. First is that we live a countercultural life. We think differently. Second is that we're prepared to have gracious conversations, as Colossians 4 verses 5 and 6 tells us. The third is that we need a pedagogical renewal. And listen, the Christian community needs a renaissance of learning to form disciples for life in exile. And what this looks like for me is that, listen, preaching is very, very important. It has never been more important to preach well than today, in today's culture, right? But it has also never been less sufficient, I think, to bring about real persuasive, transformational life change on its own to disciple people. And here's what I believe about this. I think that we have been really good at developing our sermon muscle, our Sunday morning communication style, and our process of teaching well and preaching well on Sunday mornings. But I think we have actually not done a very good job of sort of lecture style, classroom style, like really helping people think through these issues. And here is an example. When it comes to issues of same-sex attraction, I think that you need something like 20 hours. You need to read some books. You at least 20 hours. Like you have to understand the contours. A great book from my friend Preston Sprinkle is called People to be Loved, and he goes through all six of the verses that Scripture talks about same-sex attraction, and he very carefully describes how it does and how it doesn't apply to our current questions of homosexuality and the LGBT community. And listen, we need to listen to people who are same-sex attracted. We can't just talk about this as though it's like someone else's problem and some people out there we don't really want to see or hear. Like, these are real individuals who experience something that, it's a sexual minority. It's not something many of us experience, but how would we think about this well? And you can't really do that all on Sunday morning. Let me just put it this way. For my kids to be able to understand and think effectively about human sexuality, again, they need to have a more significant course, a set of material, a curriculum really that helps them understand God's design for human sexuality. And friends, I just don't think that many of our churches we don't really have the structure for that. We're doing the sermon on like high def, but all the other phases of life, it's like it's on dial-up speed, right? Let me show you now one other, this is my fourth point, which relates to this, which is vocational discipleship. This is a fourth way we can respond to the questions of irrelevance and extremism, and it's vocational discipleship. We need a richer theology of faith and faithfulness in life's complex callings. Let me just show you how important it is that we do vocational discipleship better. And I'm going to use an example of a friend of mine. His name is Mark Ranow. He works at one of our clients. And his 8-year-old boy named Keaton did a PowerPoint life plan, which I think is the most awesome thing in the world. I told Mark he has a standing job offer. Keaton has a standing job offer to come work with the geeks at Barna Group, right? These are Keaton's 5 life plan slides. Here's his title slide. Here is his 10 life goals that he has. I'll read these to you. He wants to grow up to be a nice Christian man. These are unedited. Get a nice wife. Get a good job, one that I like. Have 2 kids, each boys 2 years apart. Grow as close as I can get to God. Make more and more friends as I grow. Work hard in school, 7. 8, believe in God wherever I go. 9, teach my kids about God and help them live their lives as best as they can. 10, do not give up in life. That is much better than my top 10 life goals. Literally, he was 8 years old then he did this. And so here's his next slide. Possible jobs, all right? Engineer, architect, hockey player, Lego designer at Legoland, California or Florida. Interesting little asterisk is that Keaton and his family live in Minneapolis. Listen, here is an 8-year-old who's already mapping out a science-oriented, engineering-oriented life plan. And here's the question. If this student, if this young family went to your church, would Keaton's aspirations as a young engineer, as a young architect, as a young geek, would he be mentored and developed into the kind of person he is meant to be? Or would that happen by accident? Would that happen by the intentionality, perhaps, of his parents? And this, friends, is the great opportunity that I think the church has, is not just to run, let's say, vacation Bible school, but vocation Bible schools, right? To help Christianize the work imaginations of this new generation, to help them understand that God has made them for a particular purpose. Here's Keaton's final slide. This is his eHarmony profile, apparently. He says his wife should be a Christian woman, humorous, hardworking, caring, energetic, strong when hurt, is a leader, likes to help others, and doesn't care what others think. Warning, will not get all of this out of a woman. I told you it's unedited, and literally that was the font size that he chose. All right, every aspect of that sweet PowerPoint makes me chuckle. But it is telling us something so important, I think, friends, which is that we live in an era when people are really interested in what they will be doing. And listen, I don't think this is actually all that brand new. Nothing's new under the sun. But I think it's important for us to realize that so much of identity now comes from our work and what we will do and how we will be defined. And listen, this is why places like Ecclesiastes speak a countercultural narrative to that you are more than you produce and you are more than your ambition. In God's eyes. I've been thinking quite a bit about this. This is an area where Barna will be launching quite a bit of work. It's part of the reason why I think I love what CCO does and my friend Vince Burens and their team, and I'm encouraged by the ways that you all think about this, and there's some things that, again, your tradition would lean right into this. But let me just show you. When I, as a market researcher, when I ask millennials, what are the 3 things that you want to do in life, and then we, or, I'm sorry, what is it that you want to do in life, and then we took those answers and we put like circles around them, right? So we categorized them into different answer buckets. And we found that about 1/2 of all millennial respondents, these were including Christian teens, were interested in entrepreneurial-related careers. All right, they wanted to be a marketer, a business leader, finance, They were entrepreneurs. They wanted to start their own nonprofit. They wanted to start their own business. That's an entrepreneur bucket. Another big bucket was science-minded, science, technology, engineering, and math. That was another big bucket. About half of all millennials were interested in that type of work. And about a third were interested in creative careers, design, filmmaking, journalism, literature, fine arts, performance arts, all sorts of things in that bucket. The reason that that adds to more than 100% is that people could mention, like Keaton did, more than one career aspiration. Now, here's the thing. What's interesting is I've got a friend named Sky Jathani who's written quite a bit about vocation, and I showed him this particular set of data about 2-3 years ago, and he said he believes that God designed work for three primary reasons. That, remember, work is not the curse. God designs us to work. In the Garden of Eden, he has a purpose for humankind to cultivate the garden and to be fruitful and all these things that work is designed to do. And he said, it's interesting because you got your three buckets there, and so he showed me his three things that he think work is designed to do. And they are creating beauty, cultivating abundance, and generating order. And these relate then, I think, to the ways that our next generation, frankly, all of us of any age, are wired, that God wants us to have, jobs of abundance, jobs that create abundance, that the dark side of that is greed and ambition and, profit margins that are unjustifiably high. Profit margins that are unjustifiably high because they're bilking people, right? In relation to creative careers, that God would use those to create beauty in the world, right? Engineering and architecture, and art. You've been in buildings, maybe designed in the 1970s, which wasn't a high point for architecture, right? Where it's like, man, what were they thinking? And then you've been in other places and you're like, wow, this is just beautiful. And your senses are actually, like Rod Dreher, maybe you know that name, recently wrote a book called The Benedict Option. He said he actually came to faith by visiting a cathedral in Europe because he said, I just couldn't imagine why people would put themselves to something that lasted generations of effort to build. And it spoke to me on a soul level that the beauty of the architecture actually created a convert who's now, one of the leading proponents of Christianity in our times. And then order, right? You want your oncologist to be a person of order. So I think that we have a huge opportunity to see a revived church. I don't want to understate, friends, the incredible pressures and headwinds that we face in our culture. I think they're more complicated than we've ever seen them. Not because human nature changes, not because God's nature changes, but because of the context, our society, our culture, the church culture. We're going to talk in the next session about how it's so easy for us to blame what are some of the symptoms on millennials, when in fact it's the culture. It's a whole different setting. And so what would we do to see a revived church? When you read about revivals, it isn't about society, become flowering for Jesus. It is about the church becoming revived and more faithful in its presence. My hope and prayer for you, the reason I came from, during a particularly hard time, my prayer for you has been that I wanted to speak this message to you about what will you do to be faithful in this really difficult time. Can you, I can't imagine you have any generational issues here in this communion, right? I can't imagine you have any problems. But imagine if you did. Could you find yourselves a place where you could be faithful in your countercultural presence, in the way you help families and young people to have difficult conversations, in the way that you think about teaching and training and pedagogy, in the way that you think about vocationally discipling yourselves of any age, but especially this new generation? Those are some of the ways that we can respond to an increasingly complex culture. I'm going to invite Bill to come up here as we close. Let me just pray quickly. Lord, just to seal this moment, Lord, help us to think effectively. Lord, would you open our hearts and minds, even our very souls, to the words that you would speak to us as leaders so that we could be faithful in this complex age. Lord, we love living today in this amazing country, in our neighborhoods, where you ask us to embody your faith. Lord, would you help us to do it, to be obedient in that. In Jesus' name, amen.